Can't believe we finally got this conversation hooked up. Richard Marx is coming to the World Cafe in Philadelphia Sunday, October 19th. Now, this is your first time at the World Cafe, isn't it?
I think it is, yeah, Steve.
Now, you played some of the peripheral places, but the World Cafe, you've got your first new album, studio album, in 10 years. Your new CD, since there are no albums, called Beautiful Goodbye. Dude, I'm looking at your bio. I can't wait for you to call, because so many of the things that you like and so many of the people that you hang out with are people that I like and I'm a fan of. Like, if you were here, we could have actually hung out together.
Absolutely. I have no doubt about it. I felt it the minute you said hello. You had me in hello, Steve.
I mean, like, Richard, the minute I saw the picture of Joan Rivers giving the finger on your Facebook page, I said, this guy's cool. This guy's got to be it. This is it.
No, I think I didn't really know her, but I thought, you know, when she passed, she was legendary, and I thought, you know, that's how she'd want to be remembered. That's how I want to be remembered. I don't think there are pictures of me giving people the finger, so it made me think, I need to start doing that. When people come up to me and they go, hey, Richard, can we get a picture with you? I'm just going to give the finger.
Exactly. It'd be a great, like, you know, inside the album on the next CD.
Absolutely.
And what a way to go for Beautiful Goodbye. You know, like you're going after the funeral sect now. Instead of having a wedding song, we have something to play at funerals. Beautiful Goodbye.
Exactly.
Now, this is a more mellow Richard Marx on this album, right?
I don't know if it's mellow. I mean, musically, it's not a rock album, that's for sure. There's one or two songs, particularly a song called Forgot to Remember, that's more of a kind of retro rock song. But no, that was not the intention. You know, I mean, I've made a lot of rock albums and fun up-tempo records, and this is not a sleepy ballads record. It's a, you know what it is, Steve? The intention was, this is a song I hope people will put on to get busy to. I mean, that's why I made this record. I thought, I haven't heard an album by anybody in a long time that felt designed for sex and seduction and consistently throughout. So I realized that I had written a couple of songs that fit that bill, that really musically worked well together. And so then I went, okay, now I get it. I'm going to write 9 more songs like this, and I'm going to tell stories about seduction, and not, you know, not the kind of romantic I will be your man forever. So I've written those, and I'm happy to have written those songs, but I wrote those songs. So I wanted to write songs that were really about the kind of, I keep calling it the dance between two people when you're circling each other, and, you know, that's euphoric. No matter how old you are, whether you're a teenager or whether you're 51 years old, that period of time when you're circling somebody new and you're trying to seduce them, it's euphoric. It's really, there's a lot of poetry in that. So that's kind of what I tried to base the album on.
You could replace Major Harris, Love Won't Let Me Wait. We could make people throw out the Kenny G albums finally. This is good stuff, Richard. Richard, this is good stuff.
Thank you, man.
Musical influences, Elvis, Sam Cooke, Earth, Wind, and Fire all play into your music. And you also, you got to tour with Ringo, and you wrote with Ringo. What was that like?
Well, the tour was amazing. I did the tour, I think, in 07, I think. When they called me for the tour, I thought that they got it wrong. I thought my name is probably right next to Ricky Martin in their but they, you know, Ringo reached out and he's done this tour called the All-Star Tour, which is, he creates a group of artists to create a band. And everybody does a song or two of their own, but really we're put together to play Beatles songs and Ringo songs. And it was an incredible tour and fun, and but the biggest surprise for me was how open and warm and inviting he was as a person. And he and I just became pals. I mean, he would, you know, we'd pull into the next town and we'd do sound check, and then there's that wait. You know, you sit at the venue for a few hours before the show, and I'd be sitting in my dressing room reading or whatever, and he would just kind of wander in and sit down, and we'd start talking. And, you know, I mean, in the early days, I thought, you know, probably the last thing in the world this guy wants to do is talk about the old days. Right. But he loves talking about the old days. He told me 200 Beatles stories that I didn't know. So, I mean, it was just a blast. And when the tour was over, he and I just didn't stop hanging out, and we had, you know, we started to hang out socially when I was in L.A., and then one day he said, you know, I'm doing a new album, I'd love you to write a song with me and sing on backgrounds on this other song, and that was a couple years ago.
Right.
And then we just wrote a couple new songs for his new album, so I just can't say enough about him. He's just a great guy. He's, you know, I've been lucky enough to work with a couple of really iconic artists. You know, Barbra Streisand is another one that I reference in this way, in that I've worked with her and gotten to know her. And the best thing I can say about both Ringo and Barbara is that on top of everything else, they're both really good hangs. They're both really good, fun people to hang out with.
You guys would be perfect. I mean, you could see that you guys would be great friends. You know, you could just, because you both got the same personalities. And, you know, from what I hear and from what I see from Ringo, what was it like taking up, you know, writing with Ringo? Just what was it like taking it up to another level?
Well, it's just super fun. You know, I mean, he really put the writing, he put me in the writer driver's seat. You know, I mean, I guided it musically and conceptually, and then he would just throw out lines and, or he'd go, no, I wouldn't sing that. Maybe you would. But it was effortless. I mean, we wrote, in fact, he was thrilled because the first song we wrote for this last album, we wrote it, I think, in 44 minutes. And he said, oh, I think that's a new record. it was, we were not trying to reinvent the wheel. That song just wrote itself. It was effortless. And we actually sat there and went, well, let's write another one. This is too easy. So writing with him is just like hanging with him. It's just easy. You know, he makes it easy. He's a total smartass. You can't just float. You know, you say something that he's going to seize. You know, he's a comedian. He's a very, very funny man. So, you know, like all those guys, they come from Liverpool. They were raised on sarcasm, and I love that because I'm a smartass too. So we get along famously.
And you hang with Fee Waybill, who's the godfather to one of your kids. He, too, is a smartass, and that's got to be a lot of fun.
He's a total smartass, and Fee and I have been best friends since I was 20 years old, 19 years old. I just had dinner with him a couple nights ago. We are thick as thieves. You know, he's the big brother I never had. And on top of everything else, you know, he's still a sensational performer and great songwriter. And, I get to hang with cool people.
Now, you really do. You were discovered by Lionel Richie, and your dad was a great jingle writer. You've got it in the family. You've got it in the bloodline. You surround yourself with it. Why did it take you 10 years to come up with another studio album?
Because I wasn't really in any hurry to make an album. I was always writing songs in between. I've made a ton of music in that period of time. It just wasn't me singing it. You know, I wrote songs with 50 different artists, you know, and
Luther Vandross,
a bunch of shows. Yeah, Luther and Daughtry and Lifehouse and Josh Groban and Barbra Streisand and Keith Urban, and I've had a couple of hits together, and Travis Tritt, and on and on and on and on. I did a project with Hugh Jackman. I helped Hugh Jackman put his one-man show together on Broadway. I did all kinds of different projects. And I was always writing songs, thinking, yeah, I'll make an album one of these days. But I was in no hurry. And I also just didn't really have a concept in mind until I thought, oh, I'm going to write an album that's the sexiest album I've ever made. That was, you know, once I went into that zone, it became really clear.
You've got to have tremendous security in yourself. You know, it doesn't sound like you ever went through that, you know, that ego thing, whereas, you know, you've got to stay in the limelight. You know, you're very happy to be in the background. You're very happy to help others. And when your time came, and hopefully that time is now, you know, you take it again to the next level. Is it hard to, like, break what you did in the 80s or break the image of you from the 80s and get, you know, reestablished for what you're currently doing?
That's a really good question. I think, you know, because the success in the 80s and really more so into the early 90s was so big, and because I'm not I never pursued much of a celebrity lifestyle, so I let the music become more famous than me. I mean, there are people that will, you know, I've actually had experiences where somebody I've met somebody, not by name introduced to them, and they'll, if music comes up, they, I've actually had somebody tell me that they're a fan of Richard Marx, and they're talking to me. They don't know that I'm Richard Marx.
What do you do? You got to play him off.
No, it's hilarious, you know. I'm aware that, I mean, there's a fan base out there that, you know, I do get recognized, of course, and all that, but the majority of the success, I think, was the songs. The songs became superstars. Like, my joke was, my songs cannot go to the grocery store without getting hassled, you know. But I can. And so I think because I never cultivated a particular image publicly, it makes it easier for me to just sort of, I'm very proud of the work that I've done, but I'm just as excited about the work I'm doing and gonna do. I just don't feel like I have, I think I've given myself a break in terms of, you know, what I have to prove. I don't really have to prove anything anymore. It's just like, I want to have fun. I want to prove things to myself. I want to challenge myself creatively. I'm working on a couple of projects right now that are very different than anything I've done, and they're creatively scary because they're not in my wheelhouse, my natural right. wheelhouse, and that's what makes it really exciting. And but here's the good news. Nothing's riding on it, Steve. It's like, if it's a huge success, it's just icing on the cake. And if it fails, so we had a great time. You know, we tried something. So that's sort of my philosophy about life right now. You know, I'm just trying to focus on enjoying my life and not letting what I do dominate it, but focus more on who I am rather than what I do.
It sounds like you are, and you make a real connection with your fan base. There's a guy named Greg Smith, which is the reason this whole thing came together. Greg is a huge fan of yours. You're going to meet him at the show.
He's a sweet man. Yeah, he's a sweet man.
Yeah, and and the more he filled me with facts about you, the more I'm saying, I can't wait to do this interview. This is going to be great. You idolized Davy Jones, and you got to meet him. I grew up as a big Monkees fan. And Davy Jones, who was taken from us so soon, you know, I was really a big fan of his as a singer. Now, how much, like, when you're watching this growing up, like, how much do you want to be Davy Jones? How much are you sitting, you know, do you see yourself, like, in a monkey style or writing kind of like that? Same thing with Ringo, you know, like, when you write, you start going into their kind of space?
I would say... There was never a point where I wanted to be that person, except Elvis. I mean, we all wanted to be Elvis.
Right.
I wanted to emulate the talent. I wanted to emulate... I mean, I was a big Davy Jones fan. I was a big Monkees fan. Elvis was the first, you know, sort of impact on me. But then I became a huge Monkees fan, and there is that story where I met him when I was a little boy, and then I was lucky enough to run into him just like a year before he died and thank him for being so kind to me when I was a kid, and we had a really great conversation, and... but, you know, it's interesting, Steve. You know, I, with the exception of Elvis Presley, everybody that has made a major impact on me musically, I have either met, become friends with, or worked with, or all of the above. Everybody. I mean, I'm fans of people's music who I haven't met, but not people that made a profound impact on me. I mean, I was a huge Tubes fan, and Fee Waybill is my best friend.
Now, was that before? So you were a Tubes fan first, and then you met Fee and became friends with him? Oh, okay.
Yeah, I met him after they had already had a lot of success.
They're incredible live. Live is what made them.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's not, you know, I've just been inspired by these people that I've gotten to know and worked with. But I believe that, you know, our paths crossed for mutual benefit, you know. I mean, great example is, you know, when I was a teenager, I mean, I was listening to all kinds of bands and singers and songwriters, but vocally, I was really a huge Kenny Loggins fan. I was learning how to use my voice by listening to Kenny Loggins records because his range was insane. He had this incredible falsetto, and he could sing rock songs, but he could sing ballads, and he could sing sort of R&B stuff, and I was just blown away by his vocal ability, and I loved his songwriting too. And sure enough, you know, when I was 20 or 21, I met Kenny Loggins, and he took a liking to me, and we ended up becoming friendly. And then years later, we ended up writing songs together. And I just had dinner with him in Santa Barbara a few weeks ago, and we've performed together, and we're talking about trying to do a tour together next year. So all of these things, to me, it's not kismet. You know, all of these things, too many of them have happened to me to make me not believe that it's for a reason.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, so
you got a lucky star.
I don't know what that means metaphysically, but it just is what it is.
It means you got to do a next album called Duets and get all these people to do one song with you each. You see, and you could make your marks on music. All right, come on. It's an attempt.
Oh, I'm going to let that one slide, Steve.
Thank you. I appreciate that. All right, Richard Marx, man, it's so great talking to you. Now, you're going to be at the World Cafe in Philadelphia Sunday, October 19th. For tickets, you go to worldcafelive.com. It has been so cool hanging out with you, and I really appreciate you coming on.
In here, buddy. I look forward to seeing you.
You got it. Take care.